So I'll be talking about the work which I have done here during my stay here at ICTS. The title is Two-Dimensionalization of Rotating 3D Turbulence Revisited. Revisited in the sense that we started with the problem of intermittency in 2D turbulence. In a while, I'll tell you what is intermittency and 2D turbulence and all. So rather than talking about intermittency in 2D turbulence, let's go from 3D turbulence to 2D turbulence. And see how intermittency behaves as we go from 3D turbulence to 2D turbulence. So a very good method of going from 3D turbulence to 2D turbulence is rotate the turbulent system. So when we rotate the turbulent system, the system slowly becomes two-dimensionalization, and that is what I'll be talking about today. So this is the outline of my talk. First, I'll talk about some basic concepts like 3D turbulence, 2D turbulence, and all, and their comparison. And I'll talk about intermittency. Then I'll talk about the numerical tool which we have used. Then some results from the computation. And then I'll conclude the talk. So 3D turbulence is like a flow past a grid. And if you go a bit away from the grid, you say that the flow becomes messy and the flow is random. So that is a good example of 3D turbulence. 2D turbulence, you take atmospheric turbulence, that is 2D turbulence. Now, in 3D turbulence, let's define some inviscid conserved quantities in the sense that when the viscosity is zero, then there are some quantity which are conserved. So in 3D turbulence, it is energy. In 2D turbulence, it is energy, but there is entropy also, is another quantity, which is vorticity square by 2, averaged over the whole space where the flow resides. Then in 3D turbulence, the energy flow is from a large scale to a small scale, which is called forward energy cascade. In 2D turbulence, the energy flow is from smaller scales to larger scales, where this entropy, whereas this entropy cascade is from larger scale to smaller scales. So in the regime, in the length scale range, where entropy goes from larger scales to smaller scales, energy actually goes from smaller scales to larger scales. That is the shuttle difference between the two turbulence systems. Energy spectrum for 3D turbulence is k raised to the power minus 5 by 3. That is standard Kolmogorov spectrum. For 2D turbulence, it is k raised to the power minus 3, standard Krishnan spectrum. Energy spectrum means the energy distributed among the modes. But in rotating turbulent systems, which are like not completely 3D turbulent system, not completely 2D turbulent systems, the spectrum, we are interested in interesting because we are interested how the energy is distributed in different length scales. So rest of the talk will be nearly centered around this energy spectrum and all. So for rotating turbulence, it is k raised to the power m, where m is approximately minus 2. It is actually above minus 2. And so this is an experimental work done by Barot et al. And published in 2002 in PRL. So this is a typical spectrum. On y-axis, I have put energy. You can put entropy or something, it's a typical thing. On x-axis, there is wave number, which is the inverse of it. It will be length scale. So this. So there is a range of length scales where this is where the energy flow is nearly constant. So that range is called inertial range, because here inertia is dominant over viscous forces. But this scale is called integral scale. Here, after this inertial range, there is a range where inertia does not play much role, or it is dominated by viscous forces. And this range is called dissipative range. I'll call it capital L, this scale capital L. I'll call this scale to be L dissipation, LD. So, okay, now I'll explain intermittency. So to explain intermittency, if you want to characterize a flow at a length scale, a very good choice would be to take velocity increments. So this is a velocity increment. If you measure it at point r and r plus l, you take this difference in the direction of the length scale. So call it velocity increment. I call it longitudinal velocity increment. So you see, this is a vector, but here I have made a function of L only. And the reason is that I am assuming that the turbulent system is homogeneous. So when it is homogeneous, it doesn't matter whether it is R or R plus X or R plus C. So you measure here or here, it doesn't matter. So the R dependence goes because of homogeneity of the turbulent system. When it comes to L, so here I am assuming that the turbulent system is isotropic. So if I measure in this direction or in this direction, it does not matter. So that is why, the only thing matters is the length of the, only the magnitude of the L vector. So that is why this increment is the function of L only. Now, we define, to characterize this probability distribution of velocity fluctuations, we define a structure function, and a structure function is like increment to the power p. Now, as I showed the spectrum there, so in the inertial range, if we assume that all the length scales are similar to each other. So if you zoom in and you see the same behavior in terms of velocity distribution, we call it self-similarity. So if self-similarity is assumed, then we define this relation. And assume that this structure function is a power law in L. Then in Kolmogorov theory, these increments are functions of epsilon, and epsilon is the dissipative energy dissipation rate, average energy dissipation rate. L is the length scale. From simple dimensional counting, you can find that this velocity increment is proportional to the length L raised to the power 1 by 3. From there, it is clear that zeta p is p by 3. You can write it like this. So if we plot for K41 theory and a general, like from experiments or from numerical experiments, we see such a plot like this, where p is the order of the structure function, zeta p is like L raised to the power zeta p 10. So for Kolmogorov theory, it is p by 3 line. And from numerical results, we see this. So we say that when we talk about Kolmogorov theory, the system is self-similar. It goes like this. But in numerical experiments, we see that it is not behaving same as every length scale. At smaller length scales, we see deviations. So quantitatively, I would say that this is the signature of intermittency, which shows that at smaller scales, the system is no longer homogeneous. There are small bursts at special bursts, and so the same self-similarity is slowly being destroyed as you go smaller to smaller scales. There's this, no, Reynolds number, see, Reynolds number is inverse of viscosity. We are not in viscous range. We are in inertial range.
The question is, just do these numbers change as you change it? These are from your calculations or from?
Yeah, from my calculation.
From the question is, if you change Reynolds number, will you get different numbers?
I would say no, there will be no difference.
So the black line will not depend on Reynolds.
Hmm?
The black line does not depend on Reynolds.
Yeah.
Does the blue line depend on?
It should not depend because I am in inertial range. So, what viscosity? Yeah, it will not depend. Hmm? No. Intermittency is defined in inertial range. So, in inertial range, viscosity is not playing much role. Reynolds number is like, if you know, Reynolds number is characterized by viscosity. So it's not coming into the picture at all. So I don't have much time, but I'll explain it in a very brief. So shell model is, so the numerical tool which I'm using is shell model. So let's write Navier-Stokes equation for incompressible flow and Fourier transform it. Now, to resolve very small length scale, like dissipative length scale, the number of degrees of freedom, they are Reynolds number to the power 9/4. Now, if you take, say, Reynolds number to be 1,000, the degrees of freedom is around, what should it be? 10 as well, 6 or 7. So, that is a huge number, and if we start computing directly, a lot of computational resources is needed. So the idea is to divide the this K space in concentric spherical shells, and for every shell, give a representative wave number. And ensure that the inviscid conserved quantities, which I talked about in the first slide, they are maintained. So from there, a generic shell model is defined like this, where this un is the velocity in kth shell, nth shell, kn is the wave number in nth shell, and this NL is nonlinear term corresponding to that shell. And here you see the interaction is like k prime to k minus k prime. So the interaction is actually taken between, I mean, nearest neighbor shells, and other shells are like ignored. And Fn is the forcing in that shell. So there are many shell models proposed in the last 30, 40 years, I'll be taking this Guaya shell model. So in the Guaya shell model, the AN B, so this is a nonlinear term. AN, BN, and CN are the constants which are obtained by ensuring that energy is conserved when viscosity is zero. The shell division is taken like this, kn is equal to k0 2 raised to the power n. For uh, For rotating turbulent system, the Guay model is defined like this, where an extra term corresponding to Coriolis force is added, where this omega is the rotation strength, un is the velocity in that shell. We have put I there because Coriolis force does not do any work. We have put it as imaginary. So some details about the numerical simulations we did. So whatever I'm talking here is about numerical simulations and decaying turbulence. Three minutes. So the initial conditions, because it is decaying turbulence, the initial conditions which are taken are 10,000. That is the only relevant information here. So here we see that for when there is no rotation, we see that this is the typical ordinary spectrum. And when the rotation is added, it is 0.1 here, then we see that there is a kink here, tilt here, and we see that there are two length scales. So at larger length scales, the system is behaving differently in the under the effect of rotation. Now, as we increase the rotation strength, this scale separation becomes larger. So here this shell number is 7, here shell number is 9 for omega is equal to 1. For omega is equal to 5, the shell number is 11. So as the rotation strength is increased, the scaling is changing and the Kolmogorov length scale is shrinking now. Okay, now again intermittency rotating turbulence, actually the numerical simulations we have done, we do not see any clear pattern there. So I have zoomed this part here. So for different omegas, we do not see any, for example, for zero, this is PY3 line. This is for zero rotation strength. Now for 0.1, it suddenly goes here. And for 0.5, it comes back. So it is not showing any clear-cut pattern. We shall investigate it further. So there is a typical, so this is like qualitative thing. For quantitative thing, the intermittency can be characterized by flatness parameter, which is defined by fourth structure function divided by second structure function square. In probability theory, it is called kurtosis. So we calculate this kurtosis. And we see that there is no clear cut pattern. So the conclusion is that a dual scaling is observed in the rotating turbulent systems. The initial subrange is shrinking as the rotation is increased. In first numerical investigation, intermittency does not seem to have some pattern or any pattern with rotation strength. This needs to be understood further. This two-dimensionalization effect needs to be tested with energy flux and entropy, because I define energy flux and entropy there. So energy flux, in case of 2D, the energy flux is from smaller scales to larger scales. So as we are increasing the rotation, we have to test whether the energy flux direction is changing or not. And these are some references. This is not exhaustive. I'm very thankful to my mentor, Samriddhi Shankar Ray. DCS organizers, particularly Amit Apte and Vishal, for creating a very friendly and positive environment for discussion every Thursday, 11 in the morning. And yeah, these are my companions here. And Deep